Now, the next artist is, I think, a major inspiration for you, Billie Holiday.
Yeah.
Did you first hear Billie Holiday with your father?
I did. But it was strangely, like, so my mother and father's music taste was always really conflicting, just like their whole relationship. Mm. But this was the one person that I listened to in both households, because I was split between both. So this was the one artist that was played at my mum's and at my dad's house. Mm-hmm. And I would say that for me, like, she was the holy grail of how I wanted to be able to sing. And what I didn't realise as a young person sort of trying to copy is that you can't sing like that until some bad shit's happened to you. Mm. So, I genuinely believe, and I say this, like, if you listen to my first album and then my fourth album, I do think my voice is better. And that's because a lot of water under the bridge. And, you know, I keep telling everyone, like, after I'd had a baby, my voice got better, like, things like that. Like, my organs just slotted into a place that was better to sing. And I don't think... And I also think that's something to sort of... There's something to be said about how tragic it is as well that I was told, and that the reality is that not many artists last across their lifetime anymore, because when you look at the past albums, like, everyone gets better with age, regardless of gender, and it is for me because of that. Mm. So, Billie Holiday, as you probably know from your sheet, she's much better than me about that stuff, but, like, she had an absolutely horrific life, which is probably why she could sing so amazingly well. And this was an album that I used to just, like, lay on the floor as a kid with my eyes closed and listen to and absorb, and I couldn't put my finger... You can't put your finger on... Like, just being a good singer, that's why shows like The X Factor and stuff are kind of entertaining, but just being a good singer is not enough. Like, if anything, it's sort of secondary to having a voice and having something to say. Mm. And I think, for me, the greatest song ever written, without a shadow of a doubt, is Strange Fruit, which is on this record. And the whole album's amazing, but... It's really emotional, and it was written by a Jewish teacher. And obviously, there's a history behind that as well, because obviously of the experience of Jewish people then being sung by in the voice of a black woman living through some horrific division. And it's about... The lyrics are directly about the way that black people were treated in America, the KKK hanging them from trees, and they are the strange fruit. And the poetry of the song is just breathtaking. And I get tearful talking about it, get tearful listening to it, and it never gets old. It's like nothing will ever, for me, nothing will ever stop that being a painful thought, that human beings could do that to each other. And the song's timeless because human beings are still being awful to each other.
Yeah, and like the whole Black Lives Matters movement as well. I mean, the interesting thing is there's a Jewish school teacher that wrote this song about racism that was so endemic in the United States and still is. But it was also a Jewish club owner and had the first integrated nightclub in New York City in Greenwich Village. His name was Barney Josephson, and it was called Cafe Society. And he is the one who introduced this to Billie Holiday, this song. And by his own direction, she closed every set with it. He asked that all service be stopped, that all the lights be turned down, off except for one spotlight on her face, and it would be her last song of the evening with no encores. So he was really also making a political statement, and she was really quite scared of retaliation. She wanted to record it for her record label, Columbia Records, but they were also fearful of retaliation. So they didn't allow her to record it, but they did release her from her contract to record this one song. She ended up recording it the first time, I think it was 1939, was the first time she recorded it for Clef Records. It ended up selling a million copies eventually, so Clef definitely got the last laugh on that. But then she re-recorded again for this album, which came out in 1956, and it is absolutely haunting.
Yeah.
Any final words before we have a listen?
No, let's listen to it.
Yeah, okay, let's have a listen.